forward. The referee blows the full-time whistle. Limerick are the All Ireland champions 2018. Galway have been stopped at the very end, right at the wire. The banks of the Shannon are overflowing. Dolores O'Riordan of the Cranberries, one of my favourite artists, wherever you are now, you must be smiling.
Hello and welcome back to the Extended Panel Sports Show, brought to you in association with Lear Media. Joining us for the duration of the hour this evening is John Kiely, current Limerick Senior Hurling Manager. John will be talking all things hurling with Wayne and Jimmy from his own time as a dual star, to why he believes that coaching is king and how he gets the best out of his Limerick Senior Hurling panel. Find out how John gets on in our rapid-fire question round, and listen as he tells us about the Hit the Woe Challenge from Milford Hospice Care. Coming right up on the Extended Panel.
We have Limerick Senior Hurling Manager John Kiely. John, thanks very much for taking the time to come on our show.
You're very welcome, Jimmy. Good to see you.
Thanks very much. Also joining me tonight, are your friend and colleague of the extended panel, Wayne Power. Wayne, you're very welcome to tonight's episode. I know as a hurling coach, you're really looking forward to tonight's chat with John.
Jimmy, great to be here and a huge honour for us to have John in the extended panel show. A remarkable manager.
Absolutely. Thanks, Wayne. Absolutely. John, I suppose it's an unusual time for everyone right now. How are you keeping yourself?
Yeah, it's busy, that's for sure. I don't really have very much time at the moment to be lamenting the fact that we're not out on the pitch. The COVID situation with school has brought a massive challenge our way. And whilst we're coming to the end of this phase of it, we'll say, for the current school year, it has been a huge challenge for the last 8 or 10 weeks. So. Yeah, it's definitely filled my mind with other concerns than training and so forth. So, yeah, it's been fine. Our lads did do a little bit after the break, the lockdown came in. You know, they tipped away with a bit of what you call kind of distance work on, you know, Zoom calls, etc., you know, hit sessions. But, you know, eventually it comes to a point where you know that there isn't going to be any action for some considerable period of time. And they've done their best, and it's time for them to have a break. So, if any of you have been following the Hit the Woe for Milford Hospice, yeah, you'll know that they've turned their attention to something different for a couple of weeks. So, it's been great fun and something totally different. Something probably very public, all right, and something that would be unusual for GAA to go so public. But I think if you look around the country, everybody in every sport is kind of throwing the shackles of modesty off a little bit and taking on all sorts of different challenges at the moment for various charity work. And we wanted to be a part of that and make our contribution to it. And, you know, the boys have bought into it really, really well. And it's been great fun. We've had fantastic fun internally within our own group with it. It's been a way of kind of staying in touch without talking hurling or talking training or having to log any values for our sessions or anything like that. So it's been great fun. And we're nearly up on 20,000. So I think by next Sunday night, we should hit 25. Who knows, maybe a little bit more. So not a bad old effort from the boys. And it's our little bit done. And we've enjoyed it.
Yeah, no, it's a fantastic effort, John. And I'm sure the boys and every Limerick supporter is looking forward to your own Hit the Woe.
Yeah, I wouldn't lose any sleep over it now, because I put more thought into it than I did into it. it might look, but anyway, it was a bit of fun here at home with the girls, you know. So they were very anxious to do it, and we're just waiting for the weekend now. All the backroom team are coming up at the weekend, so it'll definitely be great fun Friday, Saturday, Sunday with the backroom team here. So.
Fantastic.
Players getting a break this weekend, and we'll make the fools of ourselves.
Fantastic. All for a mighty cause and fair play to you for doing it, you know. But you speak of home there, John. You're from Galvalia, a village just at the foot of the Galtee Mountains. A football stronghold, really. I'm sure from a young age, GA was a massive part of your life growing up.
It was huge, yeah. Always was, really. We lived in the village. We had a pub in the village. And at the side of the pub was an alleyway down to the GA field. And there was a 60 by... 30 alley down there, you know.
Yeah.
An open air one. So I would have spent countless hours inside there, hurling away, and the evenings, especially after getting off the bus coming from secondary school. Dinner in our house was at 6, so I used to get off the bus at 5, so 5 to 6 was hurling time. And I come back in a lather of sweat to the dinner, you know. But yeah, the pitch was right beside it then as well. And it was, as you say, predominantly football. There was a junior B hurling team, right? But predominantly football. Would have been senior football, you know. Mike Quish, Timmy Cummins, Johnny Cummins, John Scully, Jer Carew, those would have been the players that would have been the stars of my younger years in Galway. You know, like Mike Quish won Ray Cup medals when Kerry were in their pomp. Timmy Cummins was played for Limerick for, I'd say, 15 years, kind of forward, savage left leg, managed to win a county with him and Mike in 1990 at intermediate level. I only came on in the last minute of the final now. I was only 17. And I won one ball and I gave it to Mike Quish. And I said, he'll definitely do something positive with it anyway. And he put it so high into the air, it came down with snow on it. And it just landed over the bar and we won the county intermediate football title. And it was an absolutely crazy weekend head in Galway after.
I'm sure, John, growing up in the local pub, like, and your family owning the local pub, like, you would have heard of stories of great Limerick players of the past and heroes of yourself, hurlers like Smossy Carroll, Jimmy Carroll, those players in the 80s.
Yeah, like the Sunday game was, I grew up to the soundtrack and the Sunday evening, you know, prelude of highlights of the weekend on the Sunday game. And where our pub is in Galway, it's on the main road between Tipperary and Mitchelstown. So back in those days, you hadn't the motorway from Cork to Dublin that would take most of the traffic from Cork. So all the Cork supporters that went to Turles would come back by Tipperary Town and Galway and would stop in our pub. So our pub of a Munster Championship night would be full with Cork people. And likewise, when Tip would go to Cork to play above in Park of Keeve, on their way home, they'd pull into us, obviously, you know, to rub it in, like. And, you know, our house would be full from top to bottom with GA people coming and going, especially during the championship. And obviously, when I was growing up then a bit older, you know, being involved in the local GA club, you know, my parents were sponsoring jersey sets and, you know, we were the go-to place for a bite to eat after a match or sandwiches or celebrations or cups or whatever was being done, you know. So, yeah, we lived a totally and utterly GA life, you know. That was, totally immersed in GA and the local community. And I have one abiding memory of Tipperary team bus actually pulled up outside our pub and came in after a Munster final above in Park and Keeve. Nicky English and Pat Fox and all the team came in, you know. Bobby Ryan, Jesus, they nearly wrecked the place, and it was great. It was a great night. Nicky English, you see, went to school in Galway. His mother taught in Galway. His mother taught me.
Okay.
And so he went to school in the Abbey as well, you know. But he never asked his, you know, his memory of his time in Galway and his mother's time in Galway or his appreciation of it. And you know, whenever he was around, he'd always drop in, you know. So I remember that night, they went to the Royal afterwards, after winning the Munster title, they went to the Royal Hotel in Tipperary Town after leaving our place in Galway and rubbing in the salt into the wounds, you know. So,
and John, you talk about community there. We'd say, I suppose, one of the big things there, you know, when you look back to your time within the playing with Galway yourself, 94, 97, you won the two senior football championships, but the Junior B hurling title in 95, I actually seen a video after Limerick won the All-Ireland in 2018 with you. I seen a video of that surfacing of your speech. You know, that was something I'd say you cherished a huge amount that day, particularly winning with friends you grew up with.
Yeah, like we had the same team. We were probably the first real underage team in the club, and we had won county titles at 14, 16, minor, 21, the whole way up along. and it was natural that we'd go on and win a junior title as well. But yeah, we eventually won the junior B. I suppose it took us two occasions to get at it, but no, we had played a lot of hurling up along the line together, you know, like every kid with their club, you know, it was the same group up along. We had played a lot together. We had some great days out, you know, in that period, you know, from kind of 1989 to 1995, you know, we were at that age, you know. But likewise, it was the end of it too, because, you know, at the time, an awful lot of the lads got work actually on the road projects, you know, a lot of these motorways were being built back then. And a huge amount of our group went away working on buildings and working on the roads. And it was the economic boom that ruined our team, really, you know. But listen, that was it. You know, they went their way and they started doing their own thing. And before we knew it, we kind of were struggling very badly for numbers. And so about 96, 97, there was kind of overtures to joining with Gary Spillane for me and playing a bit of senior hurling. So that was really that period, but it was a great time. It was a great county title with phenomenal memories of it, you know. Great guys.
Yeah, I know it's nothing better than winning with your own and winning with the lads you grew up with. But we'd say, John, coming from a junior B hurling club and coming from a football area, you know, you played minor under 21 and senior hurling with Limerick then. You know, you achieved a huge amount with Limerick. What you achieved was massive.
You know, I was involved kind of with, in you know, inter-county level from a very young age, really. You know, the Tony Forrestal to going down to Waterford was the start of it, really, you know. But before that, I remember we won the, what was the Mackey Cup, you know, it was an interdivisional primary schools competition that's on in Limerick every year. And obviously after Mick Mackey. And we lost the final of that one year when I was in fifth class. And then the year after, we won it when I was in sixth class. And It was a huge win for us, and they took us down then, a kind of a selection of primary school kids, they took us down to Kilkenny to play a challenge against Kilkenny years ago. And a fella down there tried to kill me.
Are you going to give us his name, John?
Well, it was Noel Skeehan's son, yeah. It was Noel Skeehan's son, yeah. And I got a right gash in my head, and I had to be taken to Kilkenny General anyway and get a break of stitches. And we started off. That's really how we started off. We like that again with the club. You know, we had a group of guys there that were very, very, you know, close together as a group. And Davy Clark, Joe Quaid, you know, we were all the same age group going up along. And we played a huge amount of hurling together, under 14, 16, minor, 21. And then on into senior. So that was kind of, it was a natural flow of us coming up along together, playing together. TJ Ryan, Mark Foley, Owen O'Neill, Mike Wallace, you know, we had a great load of players, you know, that were, you know, very talented and very committed. And we had great fun. John Flavin from Morney Gay, great friend of mine, still great friends today. We played together. Oh, there's a load of them there. I just, you know, I hate naming names because you're going to leave somebody out. But, you know, we had great fun together and got to a Munster under 21 final in 1993 and just beaten by a point by Cork above in Park Kiev. Brian Corcoran was playing with Cork at the time, Barry Egan. And Brian Corcoran actually caught a 65 off the top of the crossbar with the last puck of the ball. It was a really tight affair, yeah. But they were a great side. They were a serious good side, and we really enjoyed our time together when we were growing up, hurling together underage.
Yeah, and now that we're kind of talking on your inter-county, I suppose at senior level, John, could you just give us an insight maybe into the three Munster finals, the 94, 95 against Clare and 96 against Tip? Like I suppose Munster hurling championship in dim days is, you know, knockout and, I suppose, in my opinion, probably some of the best Munster Championship games were played during that era.
Yeah, the 90s was a very competitive era in Munster. You know, you had your Clare and ourselves, obviously, kind of with a rejuvenation and a fresh coming of a crop of players who were very, very talented, you know. Frankie Carroll, Mike Hoolan, Kieran Carey, Barry Nash, or Mike Nash, I should say, and Declan Nash. Ger Hegarty, Gary Kirby, Kieran Carey, Barry Foley, you know, the list goes on and on and on, you know, Mike Galligan, Leo Connor, you know, Brian Finn. Jesus, there was a savage list of players, you know, they were all very, very talented guys. And yeah, I was just very, very fortunate to make the panel in 94. I was playing Fitzgibbon Cup with UCC and had a good campaign, and had obviously the experience of getting to the Munster final under 21 the previous year. So, you know, I was probably, that was a big help to me at the time, because we had played Waterford actually down in Waterford, Wayne, in that 21 campaign. And there's a very good story about that game actually, because we were very, very poor in the first half down in Waterford, and Waterford, I think, took a kind of a, I think it was an 11 or 12 point lead at halftime, and we were going nowhere. Like, and the dressing room at halftime, you know, wasn't a great place to be now, and there was a lot of fellas challenged each other inside in the dressing room, I should say, and we made a few changes. To be honest, the lads on the line, they made a few changes in the second half, and fellas that came in made a big impact, and we actually won the game, I think it was 9 points, I think we won the game. And
your turnaround.
It was cataclysmic. Like, it was off the Richter scale. And that was a seriously good Waterford team, because I think they'd won the All-Ireland year before. So, yeah, that was a massive win. We beat Clare in the Gaelic Grounds in the semi-final, and then we went to Cork for the final. So, you know, we had a campaign, if you like, and people joined us along the way in the campaign. And, we nearly pulled it off, but it was a very enjoyable time for us. And it was a good campaign. It set us up well for lads coming through the following couple of years, you know, that bit of an experience.
Yeah, exactly.
And it all started blowing Waterford that night. Ended up blowing Doon at a Jimmy Buckley concert afterwards. So.
There was a good spin back to there anyway, I'm sure, along the way.
Far cry from coppers anyway, that's for sure. But, yeah.
And you just kind of touched it out there, John. You just kind of mentioned your time in college. I suppose I just kind of want to get an insight into, like, how did you balance that third level education? Like, I suppose you were in CIT, you were in UCC, you ended up finishing in UL in 95. You won a Freshers All-Ireland medal with CIT, 3 Fitzgibbon Cup finals, 2 with UCC and 1 with UL. Like, I'm sure the real benefits of college is hurling kind of throughout your time in university, like, stands to players. Like, but how difficult was that balancing act at the time for you?
Listen, I've been asked about it. If there was a course called 001H for hurling in college, like, that was the course I would have been applying to. Like, it wasn't on the CEO list, so I had to make do. So I had a very, very rocky start. I went to Galway first for a month and did politics and things up there, and I realised quickly that, you know, getting back for training and all matches and things was going to be a bit of a struggle. Like, there was probably only the one bus route, like, you know. So I had my eye. My next choice in the CEO actually came up then as a late offer. And I was above in the King's Head in Galway when the phone rang. And I remember I was after being to a debate, and Brendan O'Connor was debating in the debate. And I was chatting a few lads from Cork, actually, who came up for the debate. And I got a phone call from my mother through the King's Head to say, listen, you've been offered this course in CIT in Cork in computer science. And that's what I wanted. And so I took off. I went to Cork the following day and signed up, and that was the end of it. Gone. So, but the only problem is I was a month late, and I struggled a bit, you know, because they had gone on through quite a bit of stuff and I was trying to play catch up. And between that and the full-time hurling, it didn't work so great the first year. So, I think by about February time, I was pretty sure it wasn't going to happen for me in terms of staying in CIT. And I started going to lectures in UCC just to see what would I like to actually do. So I spent the last probably 8 or 10 weeks in UCC going to lectures. And the following year, I switched over then to UCC and did first arts, economics, maths and computers. And I managed to stick at that one then this time and finish it. So, yeah, I did that. My degree was economics and maths, and very much enjoyed it. Yeah. So, really enjoyed my time in fairness with CIT too. You know, with Noel Collins in CIT. Noel's an institution out there. You know, we had a great team Brian Cochran, that nemesis again, who was involved in the 21 match. Brian was out there, Barry Egan was out there, Tom Gleason, there was a really great crop of lads out there at the time, you know. And they played Fitzgibbon for a couple of years after that as well, you know, with that crew. And we would have met them, you know, when I was playing with UCC then the following year. Robert Fenton from Effin was involved as well. He would have been involved with the Limerick 21s at the time as well. So yeah, it was a very enjoyable time. Great rivalry between the two colleges. And when I went into UCC, I would have immersed myself in hurling, you know, pretty much every single day. There was a couple of hours involved in hurling, going to training in the farm, you know. You had to get a bus out to the farm in Cork to train back in those days and bus back in. And that was in the middle of the day every week, you know, 2-3 times a week. So I became chairman of the club in 1994. I would have been involved with the first of the sports scholarships coming into play in UCC GA circles through O'Callaghan Builders Developers and through Davy Stockbrokers. So that was all in conjunction with Paddy Crowley and Brendan Mullen and O'Callaghan Developers. So that was a big step, I suppose, at that time for businesses to get involved, you know, kind of public-private partnership in scholarship provision within third level. That was the start of it back then, you know, back in the mid-90s. And my good friend Jerry Maguire and Damien Quigg were two of the early recipients of the scholarships. I didn't do a good enough job to ensure that I got one for myself. But, two good friends of mine ended up getting them, you know.
I'm sure the boys bought you a few pints down below.
We actually did. We did have a couple the first night, there's no doubt, yeah. We lived together in a rookery on Minerva Terrace. It was a bit of a dive, but listen, we were happy there at the Menses. But so we lived a very much a hurling life and attended lectures as well periodically. balancing hurling and education in third level, I wasn't what you'd call a model of how it should be done, I'd be honest with you. But listen, we would have, back in those days, it was all exams at the end of the year. And, you know, the hurling would be over from, you know, maybe March, early March. So, you know, you would have studied flat to the mat for 3 months, you know, day and night. Yeah. And the exams were later as well, you know, they went out to the end of May into June. And, you know, it was just a different system, you know, and we got on fine. We worked hard. We worked in teams as well. We lived in houses with guys who were studying similar stuff. So, you know, we all helped each other out, and we got on fine.
Brilliant.
And everybody went on to do very well afterwards. And we loved our time in UCC. We had a great time there. It was a great sports office there. There was lots of lecturers who were very, very good to us as well, you know, in terms of directing us in the right direction. Like Cahill Casey was involved. John Considine was involved lecturing in economics in UCC at the time. Dr. Paddy Crowley, who was still involved with UCC, was involved with UCC at the time. The famous Canon Michael O'Brien was our coach at the time. Jeez, an extraordinary individual. And, you know, Emmett Harrington, Tom Quealy from West Clare was up there. Tom is teaching down in St. Flannan's, I think now. I think that's where he is. Or else it's in Caymans and Shannon, actually. I think it's Caymans and Shannon. But like, we some great, great people there, and we, brilliant players came through. You know, Frank Lohan came through, Tim Coffey. You know, we had some brilliant players. Alan Brown, Dickie Sullivan, who's a physio with Cork. And it was a very, very enjoyable time, and I wouldn't regret a single minute of it now, to be honest. Yeah. We were unlucky. You know, we had a good team. We had plenty of good teams. Probably the one that really slipped us was down in Waterford against UCD. It went extra time. I think it was 93. That was definitely one that shouldn't have got away from us, you know.
Yeah.
But it did. And then I went to UL to do my grad dip in education business for the teaching side of things with Tom Kelly down there, and played with UL against UCC, and sure, UCC turned around and win their first Fitzgibbon in whatever 4 or 5 years. So, yeah.
Jesus.
It just wasn't meant to be, you know. And I'm a great believer in that if something is for you, it won't pass you by. And again, if something isn't for you, well, you can chase it all you want, but it won't come to you, you know.
So that Fitzgibbon Cup is a fantastic tournament, like, John, isn't it? It's very difficult kind of one to win, really.
Yeah, we've even gone back after we qualified. We went back to go to Fitzgibbon Cup weekends, you know, to meet up with our own colleagues, you know, of our time. We'd all go back and meet up again, you know, Jerry Maguire, Damon Quigley, and myself would often go back to the matches and go back to Cork or wherever to be on, and meet up, you know, and have reunions and, you know, blame who was responsible for losing this one and that one and the other one, you know. It was always the chairman of the club was wrong because Kiely was the chairman of the club. we had great times and, I don't regret a bit of it, you know. That's why I'm very disposed to the lads participating, you know, as much as they possibly can, and if it's given, you know, with us, you know, and we've always had a very, very positive engagement with the Fitzgibbon Cup from our panel, and yeah. And the players know that. They know the competition means a lot to me, and, you know, if they win it, we don't go near them for, you know, a couple of days, and if they lose it, we leave them alone for a couple of days as well, you know. It means an awful lot. It means so much to players to get a Fitzgibbon Cup medal. It's huge, like, you know. Huge bragging rights, you know, and it's a huge accolade to have a Fitzgibbon Cup medal. It means an awful lot to guys, and you only get the one chance each year, and only one college is going to do it. And generally, you know, a college will get on a run, like you used to see the last 2 years, they're on a run.
Yeah.
We've seen Mary I on the run, we've seen UL get a couple there in a couple of years. You know, Waterford were a huge stronghold back in our time, and now they find it very difficult to get a win, you know. The same with UCD. Every now and again, they come with a great team, and they're there, thereabouts. Now, DCU, the last 2 years, have been very close. Mm-hmm. NUIG have been very good and just kind of got on the wrong side of the draw, if you like, you know. It's a real challenge. Great competition. Great competition.
The three universities at Limerick, John, have really benefited. Our Limerick, let's say, senior hurling team has really benefited from three solid, really solid universities in the county.
Yeah, it's a symbiotic relationship, you know. What's good for one is good for the other. If Limerick's going well, it's good for the colleges. If the colleges are going well, it's good for Limerick. You know, we've had a good crop of players come through that 21 crew from 2015, 2017. And, you know, they have been the players who have predominantly been involved in those Fitzgibbon Cup campaigns, which Mary I, LIT and UL. So they've contributed handsomely to their performances in those competitions. They probably have attracted a few players to come into those colleges that mightn't ordinarily have come in. It's a big selling point, you know. Sport in universities is a huge selling point in drawing in athletes into the colleges. There's a big effort made by colleges to attract students who have a strong sporting pedigree into the colleges. And, you know, the bursary system now and the scholarship system is a big attraction for students as well, you know, massive attraction, because it's such an expensive, thing for families to be able to put somebody through college. It's such a big, big expense. Yeah. You know, any easing of that burden and any enjoyment that can be got on top of that by being part of a successful hurling team or a group, you know, those are the friends you're going to have after third level, or the fellas you met in the club, you know, be it the hurling football, soccer club, rugby club, you know, all the sports organisations that are there.
I'm just going to stop the lads there because we have to take a quick break. I really hope that you're enjoying the show. Don't go anywhere. In the next part of the show, John gives us a great insight into the Limerick Senior Hurling Camp as he details the importance of coaching, conditioning and the psychological aspects of the game. Stay with us.
To present this cup here today to John Kiely, and John Kiely holds a unique record. He's the first Galway man to wear a Limerick jersey in Croke Park. And I have been associated with John as a selector for both minor and under 21. I think he's a young man who has shown wonderful commitment and wonderful dedication. He's given wonderful service to his club and to his county. And it is my pleasure now to present him with the County Cup on behalf of the County Board.
John, we'd say you spoke there about some great players you've played with Limerick. You played within university, within UCC, CIT and UL. But, you know, before you take the plunge into management, you watched the Limerick teams play from the stand as a supporter. From the period of 2000 up to 2009, Limerick reached two Munster finals and the All-Ireland final in 2007. But is it fair to say that the All-Ireland semi-final loss to Tipperary in 2009 was the catalyst that drove you to get into Limerick management?
Yeah, I suppose I had a background of being involved with coaching through, obviously, school. You know, I was teaching from 97 on, right? And, you know, in a secondary school, you could be over five or six teams, you know what I mean? Between the Hoppin and Trotton, you're going to be involved with a lot of teams if you're involved in sport. And, you know, that was a big part of my hours in school was, you know, looking after the teams with Paddy Kelly there from Kilmallock, who was also a B teacher in Tipperary. He was one of the original Thomond qualified P teachers. So, I got a great grounding in team management with, you know, from Paddy and from coaching with Paddy. But yeah, I would have done a bit of club coaching then maybe when I retired from playing in 2006 and looked after a couple of, listen, there were local junior teams really, you know. Looked after Gary Splann as a senior team, my own club team then for a year. And we got to a county semi-final and we got pipped by Niall Moran and Ahan. Anyway, 2009, you're dead right, yeah. We were in Croke Park at the match, you know, and I don't know, listen, at the end of the game, obviously we were disappointed and so forth, but whatever got into my head, I said I'd give Liam Linehan a ring and just offer to get involved. There wasn't very much thought put into it, only by the time we got to the M50 and to the Red Cow, my mind was made up, you know, so. Anyway, they asked me to get involved with the intermediate team in 2009, for 2010. That was during the strike and very, very difficult time. And, you know, it was very, very hard to get players to get involved.
Yeah.
But anyway, we got there, I suppose, through a lot of hard work and we ended up playing Cork in the first round in Barclay Keeve. And my past college colleague, Pat Kennelly, was over Cork at the time. And so it was two college mates going at it on the sideline. And, you know, we had a lovely team, actually, and very committed bunch of guys. I was really, really proud of that performance that day. You know, we took them to extra time. Should have won it in normal time. Should have won it in extra time. And they eventually just got there with a play that ran against us. We were caught, actually, with our defence unset. It was a play that we didn't finish and put to, you know, we didn't put the ball dead at the other end. And we got caught in the transition. And that was it, game over. And they went on to win the All-Ireland Intermediate the same year.
Yeah.
And did a great, you know, really good side now. A lot of lads went on to play for Cork afterwards that were on that side. And Richie McCarthy was on our team. Richie played midfield centre forward that day. Yeah, had a great game. So the same the year after, then I was involved with the Intermediate team again. We got beaten by Clare in the Munster final down in Innes. And was involved with the 20 under 21s as well in 2011 as a selector and coach with Leo Connor and Pat Darvin and Pat Donnelly. And Pat Donnelly obviously has been involved with the academy now and in Limerick and was involved with the 21s in 2017. So we had a great time, great group. We got on like a house on fire, the management team, and we had a great bunch of lads, and we had that incredible final with Cork on an incredible evening, you know. Very good side with Graham Mull, you know, Kevin Downs, Shane Dowling, Decky Hannon. Really great side, great side. And just an incredible game that same night. You remember maybe Aidan Walsh was playing week four for Cork and he got a good few points in the first half. And we did a job in trying to lock him down, you know, in the second half, but we did a good enough job in it. But it was a tremendous game. It was a game for the ages. And we got beaten in the All-Ireland semi-final in that year by Galway. Didn't play great in that game. Just Galway were much better than us. Remember David Burke had a fantastic game, same evening. So the year after then, what was that? That was going into 2012. I got involved then with John Allen with the seniors the following year. And then in 2013, we had another go off it. And we managed to get over a very disappointing league final against Dublin in Thurles, where we played exceptionally bad and turn it around and get a good Munster campaign into ourselves and got to a Munster final in the Gaelic grounds. And, you know, it was a sunny day. And as you have, you know, when the sun shines in the Gaelic grounds and Munster final there, you know, it's the wind is at your back. Like, you know, it's much easier to, or it seems that way. You know.
I was there that day, John. That game was like, you are right, the sun was shining, but the atmosphere in the Gaelic grounds that day was serious.
There was an all hunger there. We'd been through a few rough years, you know, and to get to almost the final now at this stage was, you know, it was a relief to everybody, you know, and people just got in behind the team, you know, they just got in behind the team. Again, you had a lot of really great characters and players there, James Ryan, Paddy O'Brien, Gavin O'Mahony, you know, lads who were after giving and were going on to give an awful lot to Limerick, you know. You know, Declan and Shane and Kevin Downs and all these guys had come through as well on it, you know. So you'd a really good profile of a team, you know, Tom Condon, another, you know, Nicky Quaid.
Yeah.
You're a great outfit, like, you know. So yeah, that was great. John Allen obviously brought a huge amount to it. Like, John Allen was just off the charts.
Right.
Would have had a huge influence on me now in terms of my learnings on how to deal with fellas and what was important, you know. Donegal Donald was our coach at the time, and Eamon Meskell was with us as well. And we get on exceptionally well. And Dunnock, again, I learned a lot from Dunnock and from Eamon as well. You know, they were great guys. I think, you know, it's all about learning, really, for me, you know, be it, you know, hurling or school, it doesn't matter. You know, it's all about, you know, what you can pick up today, what you can learn today. And things have to change and evolve. So you have to be willing to see the way the trends are going. And, you know, that was all part of that process. I think I learned an awful lot during that two-year period, you know. So I took a year out then in 2014 because I got the job in school, you know, and, you know, I just couldn't commit to anything, you know. And John Allen moved on as well then as well, and Dunnock moved on, and John Eamon Meskin moved on. So at a year out, I was in school, and then Oliver Mann came back to me then the year after, about the 21s, you know, to get involved with him, and in 2015. So I suppose I came with a bit of experience of having been with the seniors for 2 years. And it was crucial because I was trying to do things to senior standards at 20, at 21, you know. And I wasn't prepared to leave things go backwards. I wanted the 21s to be at a senior level, and that was it. So the boys bought into it. We had great fun with our video analysis, even though it was, you know, it was an agricultural setup, you know, it was my own setup. Like, we hadn't any great technology or staff or anything like that, you know, but it worked. And with some, you know, the boys did a lot of learning that year. They learned a lot, I think, you know. And they came out of a brilliant academy where they had, you know, the boys were well grounded. They had lots of experience from big days. They had a lot of disappointment at the same time, and that fed into their appetite for it. And, you know, their attitude was good. That was the most important thing. They came out of the academy with a really good attitude. And they were very, very close as a group of players as well. So it made it easy to work with them, to be honest with you. So yeah, we had a really good, enjoyable year. We won a fantastic Munster campaign. And that first game against Tipperary in the Gaelic grounds was actually the, you know, that was the kickoff point. We needed to get a breakthrough, and that was the breakthrough game, really. And we just pushed on from there. And the team got better and better as the year went on, you know.
Yeah, no, that was a savage game that night in the Gaelic grounds. I remember, if memory serves the correct, your goalie makes a great save right at the very end.
It was, yeah. Dave McCarthy was incredible. Absolutely incredible.
Just
point blank save from who the heck was it? Was it Brian O'Mara, was it? Jeez, I think it was Brian O'Mara. But it was just, he pulled off three or four incredible saves that night.
Yeah.
He got man the match. He got man the match. Yeah.
He was outstanding in the goal that night. But John, you talk about your time there, say, from your intermediate up to under 21 in 2015. And the many roles you've held, being a senior selector as well, you talk about learning. Like, if you could put it into two or three things that you've learned, that you've brought into the senior setup as manager when you got the job in autumn of 2016, what would they be that you said, yeah, I've got to bring this with me?
Number one is very simple. Coaching is king. And that's that. I'm very, very fortunate that we have had, and I've worked with, you know, all those lads I would have mentioned there, you know, Jimmy Quilty and John Flavin and Leo O'Connor, Pat Davern, Pat Donnelly, you know, and many more. But, you know, with the current group, would say we've had obviously Paul Kinnark is our league coach, and you know, we've had Jimmy Quilty and Brian Geary and Alan Cunningham. Angus O'Brien has joined us this year now, and Don O'Grady has joined us. But you know, the coaching side of it is huge, and it has to be spot on. It has to be well planned, well thought out, and well executed. And you know, we get that with Paul and with the other coaches. So coaching for me is key, because you only have the players for that certain amount of time each week. It's only maybe four to five hours a week on the pitch. You have to make that 4 or 5 hours count for as much as you possibly can. So the coaching side of it is vital. The second aspect of it is obviously the physical side of it. And you know, we were very fortunate to have Ross Corbett involved with the 21s back in 2015. And he did a brilliant job with him. And then subsequently with the seniors, Joe O'Connor was there from Rakeel originally, but living down in Tralee now. Nicest fitness. And Joe like is just, you know, he'd been there and done that with Clare. You know, he's worked with Olympic athletes, he knows his stuff, like he's top of the game. And that's the hurling, that's the physical, and the third one then obviously is the psychological. And if the psychological, you know, and when I say psychological, I'm not talking about, you know, the shrink psychologist, if you like.
Yeah.
I'm just talking about the whole mental approach to what you're doing, you know.
Yeah.
You know, be it the necessity to have fun, you know, be it the necessity to have unity and togetherness within the group. They're vital, vital components, but they all come under the one umbrella of the whole psychological approach to the group and the psychological dynamic within the group. And if you have the three of those boxes ticked right, you won't be far off the mark, I think, you know. With any team, in any grade, at any level, you know. But it's to get that right is the thing, you know. It's a huge challenge to get that much right. And then you have all the other stuff that goes around it, you know, in terms of supports, analytics, analysis is huge as well, obviously, from a learning perspective. You know, medical is huge. Diet is huge. You can't discount any of them. But those three, for me, are the foundation stone. Because if you're missing the coaching, it won't stack up. If you're missing the physical, it won't stack up. And if you're missing the correct or appropriate psychological approach, it won't stack up. So you take out any one of the three of those and nothing works.
Yeah, that's brilliant. And that sports psychologist, John, I suppose it's hugely important. And you just touched on it there. And if you don't mind, I might just mention Caroline Currid there, who has worked with you in 2018. And I know she's back with you again this year, and she's a fantastic reputation and some brilliant work. And look, her results speak for herself in terms of winning 4 All-Irelands in 2 different codes and that. But I suppose I'm just kind of wondering, like you've mentioned how important it is to the whole group, but like, does she do work individually with the players, or is it, I suppose, within that group setting and scenario during a training session, or is it visualization? Or I'm just kind of trying to get an insight into the work that she might do.
Yeah, listen, it's multifaceted. It's multifaceted. And that's why I use the word approach as opposed to anything more specific, because it's in everything you do.
Okay.
It's in every single thing you do. There is an aspect to everything you do that has a psychological aspect. And it's ensuring that that aspect is of an appropriate approach in terms of attitude. And
yeah.
I suppose if I were to give you a simple example, a simple example would be, you know, we have big panels. We have 36-man panels, right?
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, you meet any fella on the side of the street there, and you say, right, who's the most important player with Limerick right now? You know, and he'll say whoever. He'll have his own favourite, whoever he might think. But there'll be another couple of dozen players that he won't think of at all or even consider. But those are actually the most important players. Because if they're not doing their business, they're not progressing. The team isn't progressing. There's no competition for places. There's never going to be any success. There's never going to be any hunger. There's never going to be any fear from an established player looking over his shoulder to see another fella come in to take his place. So, you know, that approach needs to be marshalled and observed and adhered to by everybody at all times, because everybody is actually really, really important. So
yeah,
there's nobody has any lesser place in the group, be it in any role, on or off the pitch. So listen, there's lots of other ways of looking at it too, but you know, obviously Caroline brings her own experiences and expertise, and her reputation, obviously, as you say, you know, stands for itself in terms of the success she's had. But she's somebody who brings a lot to the table, but at the same time is somebody who loves to learn and develop herself in her own field. And yeah, we push the boat out. We try things, and some things work, some things don't work, but I've learned a lot, I can tell you, in that sphere. Something I'd like to maybe look at maybe down the road, the whole aspect of sports psychology from an aspect of maybe getting involved in it myself. But it's very, very interesting, and I would put huge value on it.
Yeah, and if I was to just ask you then maybe, John, and do you know in 2017 when you lost to Kilkenny, like I suppose it was a game that you probably could have won. Like, I suppose the players would have gained huge experience from it. Like, but I suppose what I'm wondering is, like, how within a 12-month period then was it able to turn around so much? Like I suppose the following year, you had Kilkenny in the quarter-final, Cork in the semi-final. You were down by 5 points to Kilkenny, and you were down by 6 points against Cork. And, like, you still came back to win, like. Like that confidence, then I suppose a sports psychologist must have had an impact on that, like, and maybe it was helping them for the coming year. Then,
yeah, I suppose we, you know, I don't know whether you were at the match in Kilkenny in Nolan Park, yeah, the year 2017, but we played actually reasonably well the same evening, but our accuracy on the night left us down, you know, and our decision making on the night in terms of how we, you know, from where we shot. So our efficiency was poor on the night, and I think we only lost by 3 points, I think. And gosh, we had a lot of wides that night. We had a lot of wides and a lot of chances we didn't take. So, you know, had we gotten over that game, you know, next thing is we were in an All Ireland semi final.
Yeah.
So, you know, It's amazing how things can change very, very quickly, and confidence comes. So I think the league, you see, the league the following year was very important, because we went unbeaten first of all until the last game, and we had to go to Galway for the last game, and that was deciding whether we get out of 1B, and that had been a huge millstone around our neck for a long number of years. And you know, we were down whatever 8 points at half time against Galway above in Salt Hill, and you know, we had to you know, we had to come back out and take the game to them. And we did very, very quickly from the very off. And, you know, we just stuck at it, and we got a fantastic victory that day above in Galway. That was a huge victory. To win that game against the All-Ireland champions, you know, in Galway, in their backyard, it gave huge confidence to the group. And that was what we were short of, you know. We had no confidence up to that point, really. Real confidence, no, you know, confidence that you can depend on, and that was very, very important, that bit of confidence. So we built on that, and you know, built with a couple, you know, we beat Tipperary in the first round of the Munster Championship. We drew with Cork, and you know, there were two tough challenges, like, you know, massive challenges, and yeah, we got something out of those games. So again, confidence was building, and we got subsequently trimmed below in Innes by Clare very badly the same day, and we didn't qualify for the Munster final. So, you know, we had a bit of time then to regroup and get organised for the All-Ireland series, and we beat Carlow in the first game of it, down in Carlow during the drought, and then we had the Kilkenny match. So, you know, it was all about building a bit of confidence and a bit of momentum, really, you know, getting a few wins under the belt. Yeah, that was really good.
I suppose, John, that when you, I suppose, look at that night in Turles, and you go to Croke Park to the semi-final, and particularly the last couple of years when you took over in autumn of 2016, you said your coaching is so important. You bring in Paul Kinnerk, when you look at the coaching style, John, and I would have watched you having played Kilkenny in 17 and 18, I was at both of those games, and the style of play, you know, your half forward line dropping out the field, the support play, the tackling, the delivery, the ball into the forwards. Is that something you regularly focus on in training, John?
I think it's something that just evolves, right, over time. If you go back in the games in 2017, you're not going to see that as pronounced. You know, that was how our team evolved into, because of, you know, the players that we had, the skill set that they had, and obviously the influence that Paul had on the group in terms of bringing his coach into play as well, you know. So, it, you know, if we had another 30 players to work on, would it have ended up the same? Maybe not, you know. But it suited our particular bunch of players, you know. And it was how that group came together on the pitch in terms of how they ended up playing the game, you know. And even in 2015, when we won the 21s, you know, we would have walked the ball through the lines quite a lot as well, you know. So, you know, it wasn't something new to them, but it had to be developed and it had to evolve. And, you know, it'll continue to evolve. That's just the way it is. You know, it's not something that's going to just be okay as it is.
I think it's a great point you make in terms of 2017. It was probably Paul's first year within the setup, and the players were probably getting used to those couple of ideas that you were probably trying to do with them.
Yeah, you just need more time. You need an incredible amount of time for all these things to be embedded, you know, into your psyche, and for them to be the natural thing you do as opposed to the thought thing you do. You have to be able to do it without thinking, and that's the difference. At that level, you have to be able to do it without thinking. I think we were just having to think about it too much in 2017, and that's probably the difference, you know. Like people say, that's how you play. But within all of that, you know, the group, the players play it as they see it too, you know. Some days you'll be posed with a different challenge because the opposition will bring a different approach, you know. That's often being the case, and that means you just have to play it a different way. So, you know, it's not like you have a set way of dealing with it or playing with it. It's, you play it as you see it. And I suppose having the players with a few different options in their armory, that's where the skill of the coaching comes in, because that's all practiced in the coaching in the field, you know. And part of the coaching work that's done. But again, I bow to a superior knowledge on that front. As I said, I've learned a lot more than I probably brought to the table in terms of that aspect of things, you know.
And I suppose, John, you talk about things in your armory there and having plays in your armory. One area that, to me, it's constantly evolving is the goalkeeper within hurling. On average, a goalkeeper will hit, you know, 30 to 40 puck outs in a match. From watching your team play over the years, particularly since yourself and Paul took him over the senior team, the not so much Nicky in the goal, but the movement of the players out the field and the detail you put into those routines must be massive, must be a savage amount of work.
The fact is that every team puts a lot of time into exposing their players to various situations and scenarios. And we're no different to any other team. We expose our players to as many scenarios as we possibly can. But at the end of the day, you know, the game of hurling is the game of hurling, and it's very difficult to bring too much of a regimental structure to it. And nobody wants to really either. You know, you just want to give the players, as I said, the ability to shift from one pattern maybe, or one approach or solution to an issue they might be in, to another one. And it's ultimately down to the decision-making processes that the players execute on the pitch as to what they do with the ball when they have it in their possession. So I'm not really answering your question as such, but I'm loath to answer it, because none of us want too much structure on something. And we love the natural flow of the game. That's the beauty of the game. So we can't stifle the natural. And yet we can't ignore the fact that, you know, training is a structured process.
Yeah.
So
it's to get the balance. Yeah.
The balance, it is a balance, yeah. And do we get it right every day? We don't. No. And some days we struggle on those set plays, as you might call them. And other days we do well on those set plays. And we go home maybe scratching our heads to know why we didn't do better on those set plays, you know. And Is it because the structure wasn't good enough, or was it because it wasn't more natural? I don't know.
That's brilliant.
I'll interrupt the lads again there for the last time. I'm going for another small break now, but if you made it this far, thanks for listening and don't go anywhere. Coming up after the break, John Kiely gives us his lowdown on how he spends his life outside of hurling and outside of school. Find out how John gets on in the quick fire round. Stay with us.
This is without doubt the proudest moment in any men's career, to captain his own club to the first ever hurling title, to come back to their parish. This isn't just the 15 boys in the field and the subs in the sideline and the mentors, John Neal, manager, Michael McCabe, Jack Dillon, Dennis Ryan, Eddie Ryan there on the background as well, and Tommy Sheehan. Anyone that has ever been involved in hurling back along the years, I don't care what Limerick jersey you wear, to win anything with your own club is better than anything. I don't care what it is.
Yeah, and it's massive amount of work like that goes into the sessions and that, John. But if I could just get your opinion now on something maybe a little off the coaching and things like that. Like, you're a manager at the highest level now within the GAA, right? What is the ideal structure, do you reckon, for the club or inter-county season? Just to ensure, I suppose, that, like, player welfare is managed, I suppose, and that the fans across all codes can witness the amazing talents of the GAA sports stars that we have in this country.
Yeah. See, the premise is that a player can play every competition.
Yeah.
You know? And unfortunately, I think that that's where the ultimate issue is. Our players are actually trying to play Munster League, Fitzgibbon Cup, National Hurling League or Alliance Hurling League, Munster Championship, All Ireland Series, Club Championship, Munster Club Championship, All Ireland Club Championship. And that's in one code.
Yeah.
And a lot of lads play a bit of football with their club, and maybe one or two might play football with their college. So I just think that there are too many competitions and that we can't play them all. So yeah. That's why, you know, ideally I'm happy not to play the Fitz boys when they're playing with their colleges. You know, yeah. It reduces their exposure to one competition in favour of another, and that's just a natural process. One is a championship, the other isn't. You know, again, you're not going to expose some players in your Munster League to very much, maybe only just what you feel is necessary or appropriate at the time. And at a club level, you know, players probably need to understand that if they're playing inter-county, it's very difficult to play both codes. And
yeah.
I just think that there's a different physical demand on them to play the football at the same time. And I just find that they're rather injury prone if they play the football, having not done the training for the football. So they often go back, possibly play football club championship, but have not played or trained football all year. And next thing they're kicking the ball 60 yards or trying to kick it over the bar or, you know, whatever it might be, picking it up. Like, you know, it's just totally different physical movements required of the player. And yeah. I just don't think it fits well. But, you know, is there a solution to the problem? I don't think there is. It's really hard. It's very challenging on the players. When we were, you know, we spoke earlier about the 90s, you know, back in those days, you had knockout Fitzgibbon. You'd knock out Munster Championship. You'd know at Ireland Series. And your club was knockout. I remember playing one championship match at my club, like, and Jeez. That was it. Good luck, you know. Yeah. So you mightn't play five or six games a year, like. So if you're, you know, competitive games. So you mightn't even, you know, if you were on a Limerick panel, you mightn't get a league game. You know, there weren't as many league games, so. You could really have a very, very small amount of game time. Whereas now, because these competitions at club level are all round robin, the Munster Championship is round robin. You know, we have a quarter final of the league, a semi final of the league, and a final of the league. You have the Munster League. Fitzgibbon is round robin. You know, there's a back door for every competition, if you like. So there's just a huge amount of games there. It's very hard to expect players to play in them all. And I don't think a player themselves should expect themselves to be able to play them all either. They need to look after their body, and they need to listen to their body. And sometimes they need to stand down or be stood down, you know. And managements need to be cognizant of the player load. And that's where the science comes into it. And the people that are studying your material inside, you know, in terms of the sports science side, you know, and the S&C side, like, it's the management of the training load is hugely important, and the injury prevention of that in particular is really important. So our S&C coaches do a tremendous job in monitoring that load for our players and with our players, and giving feedback to the coaches in terms of what it is a player can do tonight at training or what he can't do. And, yeah, you know, sometimes a player might need to finish up after an hour. Sometimes it might be no contact. Sometimes it's just straight line running. You know, depending on where they're at in their recovery or rehabilitation from an injury, or their levels of fitness, you have to really taper it. It's not, you can't go to train and say it's the same for every player tonight, no matter what, because every fella is different. So in kind, the session has to be different for everybody as well, almost, you know. Obviously, you're trying to work towards getting everybody fit, healthy, well, and able to participate in all of the session. But for the vast majority of the year, you never have everybody in that position. Very rarely. You're always going to have somebody who is compromised in some way in terms of their ability to participate in the session.
Yeah.
But it's great because we have the technology, we have the science, we can help players prevent themselves from acquiring serious injuries. And that's really important.
Yeah. I suppose just with my last couple of questions for you, just to kind of go away from hurling now, I suppose at the moment, I suppose we all know the passion-filled John Kiely that we see on the sideline and in post-match interviews. But what are the things that John Kiely does to switch off from hurling? Are there other sports that are of interest to you? Or has the lockdown maybe given you time to improve on any other hidden talents that we don't know about yet?
You know, when you're being a principal of a secondary school and being involved with Limerick and the home life, obviously, then as well, there's very little room for anything else, you know, very, very little room for anything else. I have enjoyed the last 8 weeks being at home, you know, for good periods of it. I've been at work, obviously, doing a bit as well, but mostly working from home and just being around home. It's been great. I've enjoyed my time with the lads here at home. We've gone out and done a lot of cycling and hill climbing, hill walking, played tennis, reading stories, reading books. You know, we've had a really great time here because I'm around. But it's not to say that I want to be here forevermore either now, but I'm looking forward to getting back training and hitting the road again. But yeah, I like watching probably Match of the Day. Saturday night is one of my little guilty pleasures. I love Match of the Day. I love watching the majors in golf on Sky Sports. I'm a big fan of the majors. I'm a big fan of Rory McIlroy and Patrick Harrington and Shane Lowry and obviously the Tiger himself as well. So, you know, I watch a lot of golf and I really enjoy watching the golf. Being honest about it, I don't play golf. I'm useless at it, I suppose. It's the primary reason I don't play, but I don't have time either. You know? And I would like to be involved a little bit more with my club, but I just don't have the time, you know, during the evenings. Like, you know, we might train of a Tuesday and Thursday, Tuesday, Friday, but, you know, when you're at home the other evenings, you're on the phone, you're watching matches, you know, you're planning, you're organising, you know, it just swallows up time, you know, it just swallows up time. But I love it. I really enjoy it. It's been very nice for us as a family to have had these last, you know, number of years involved with Limerick at 21 and senior level, and our girls growing up with it and going to matches, and it's part and parcel of our life here at home, and we're very happy doing it. And for as long as we're happy doing it, we'll continue to do it, and for as long as we're wanted, we'll do it. Perfect. Whenever it finishes, I'll be happy to buy my season ticket and head off in support from the stands.
Lastly, and just to finish up for a bit of fun, if you're open to it, we'd like to do a quick fire round with you. I'll pop you on the timer, and I'll give you a list of 10 rapid fire questions. So, 3, 2, 1. Favorite hurler?
Kieran Kerry.
Piano man or Limerick, you're a lady?
Oh, piano man.
Favorite documentary?
Favorite documentary? Jesus. Would you call Chernobyl a documentary? I don't know.
Okay, Klopp or Guardiola?
Klopp.
Man.
Favorite stadium?
Oh. Yeah, that's a tough one to get in with. Yeah. Yeah, listen, I love the Gaelic grounds. I've been in there since I was a child. Love it. Yeah, I'm very happy with it. Very happy with it.
Grip or no grip?
All grip.
Favourite music you listen to?
Oh, yeah. I'm actually listening to that Moncrief at the moment. Jesus, is brilliant.
Very good.
Hurl or hurley?
Hurl.
Rugby or soccer?
Jimmy, it's a tough one now. Rugby.
A final one, John. Your favourite podcast?
I've only listened to one. Oh, God.
Brilliant. What? Brilliant.
Well, John Kiely, it's been an absolute pleasure. And, you know, you're what you brought to Limerick Hurling. And I tell you, that phone call you made back in 2009, coming out of Croke Park, or the following day after Croke Park, surely Limerick have seen the absolute benefits of that. And, you know, it's been a pleasure for us to get an insight into the way you think and, you know, the values that, you know, you want your team to be able to go out and to be able to play and how you want to play the game. You have a fantastic team at the moment, and we wish you the very best of luck for whatever the future holds for yourself and Limerick Hurlers. Stay safe, John, and look after yourself, and we'll keep in touch.
Okay, thanks, Jimmy. Thanks, Wayne. It was a pleasure, boys. Great talking to you.
Thanks, John. Bye.
That just about brings today's episode to a conclusion. Thanks again to Limerick Senior Hurling Manager John Kiely for a fantastic interview and for joining the lads today. If you've made it this far, thanks a million for watching. I hope you enjoyed the show. If you're listening on Spotify, please follow the page and maybe check out our Instagram and Twitter pages at Extended Panel. Looking forward to seeing you next week with another episode of the Extended Panel.